talking about the word being the logos, being the Greek word of logos meaning the complete thought and concept of God. We found that this was true in the beginning, before creation, before what we call the beginning. Our beginning is we started, or mankind started, or whatever we always. Everything that we understand usually has to relate to us for us to be able to understand. But this beginning that the scriptures talk about was before creation. And it's a beginning that is related to the Father and how he views his Son, and he views him as the Logos, and that is all it says. It doesn't describe Jesus, it doesn't describe the Son of God, it doesn't describe the Savior, it doesn't describe the Lord. It describes the relationship between the Father, it's called God. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. That relationship is, and since there's nobody else in existence, as far as mankind, the relationship between the Father and the Word, and Jesus is seen to be the center of that by being described as the Logos, the complete, which the word is translated as Logos, the complete thought and concept of God. So there is no fall as of yet. There is no creation for man to fall in. There's no tree of knowledge of good and evil yet. There's no devil that has tricked everybody. There's only the Father and what he calls the beginning is God the Father relating to the Word, the Logos, this one that is his complete thought and concept. Okay, so if that's true, if before anything else, if it's the Father and the Word, before anything else, and that all things, like verse 3, because we're still not by verse 1, verse 3, all things came out of that. All things, it does say that all things were created by him without him, without him, without him, without him, without him. So it all emanated here. And it all had its beginning there. So the true beginning for us, even especially those of us that are born again, is not at our creation or at the creation or our birth or our new birth. But it goes all the way back to the beginning. And it is, and we found, and we are in the beginning because we are here found in this one, who is the complete thought and concept of God. So, to relate to the Father is to relate to him through, we always say, through the Son. Okay, well, that still doesn't get it. It's to relate to him through the complete thought and concept that he's got, called the Word. We call him Son because that helps us understand it later on. The Bible calls him that. We call him Jesus because later on we will find his name being brought up and all this. But you got to get, we've got to break, the example I always think of is when God put together the tabernacle, he started with the Holy of Holies where the presence of God was, and he began to build each of the parts and go from there, and then, but he started with the answer and then he built all this other stuff. But when man approaches God, we start with the door, the altar, the labor, and then we enter into the holy place, and then eventually we end up. But that just shows you because we're finite. We're working our way towards, so funny, we're working our way towards the beginning. We're working our way towards the beginning. And we saw in the Eternal Plan of God class that this beginning that we're talking about is the one that always was the plan. That the plan of redemption was simply to get us back to a starting point so that we could begin to enter into the It's as if the Father starts here with the logos, the complete thought, complete concept. And then for us to begin to come up with different names that describe different aspects that relate to us. But for him, the word, the complete thought concept is just it. So for us to understand that the way that we relate to God, the Father, is we are in the beginning. And we're not even described as there, but we are there in the heart of the Father. We're there. All of us are there. I'm not going to preach all the classes we've had up now, but we need to go back and listen to some of the classes. We went down to Scripture, Psalm 139 and others, and show that before it all started, we were there. We were counted as his member. We were one with this complete thought and concept of God. Of course, then you begin to discover, Ephesians is a great place to discover this reality where it starts off. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Not that didn't say in heaven, in heavenly places. In Christ, it begins to describe everything relating there. And it says that we have this before the foundation of the world. It was ours. And you're going, well, I wasn't there. Yeah, you were. You were seen. You were understood by the heart of the Father. And if I may say this, it's not even necessarily that you personally or your personality was seen. But all that would be of the group of whom that he wanted would be found in Christ. And that's why the scriptures say you're complete in him. We look and say, well, I'm more complete than you. You're looking at him. You're not looking at him. Because he is our completion. You're accepted. Well, I did more things acceptable than you today, but you find that we're all accepted in the love. And the way I like to put it, I don't know if you'll understand it this way, but the way I like to put it is, it's a whole different economy than what we have this way of relating. And it's all very much the way we did this last week. Here's the beginning, you know, as far as creation begins. That's, you know, that is the end of time. And that's probably the best way to put it. Here's the beginning of time, or here's the beginning of the linear, the end of it. Somewhere on there, you were born and you died. You do a lot of stuff. What are you going to do? I do a lot of it. But in reality, if you got born and you do a raised up, then you sit together in. And there you are, all complete. And there he is, your peace. And he is all of this. That means very little. You know, him being your righteousness means very little to a person who marks his righteousness by his daily acts. Him being your hope means very little if you're doing things that are making you feel hopeful. You're drawing from that. I mean, good. Do righteous acts. Do good works. The Bible encourages that. It never says to count that as your righteousness or your relationship with God. It's your faith in the one that you are having place where that faith is your righteousness. So if you start out pretty lousy, you don't ever do anything good. So if you just completely fall on Jesus as your righteousness, but later on you get pretty good confident about it. You don't have a daily faith, but you're trusting in the Lord. You understand what I'm saying? Your faith is more in, hey, I'm doing pretty good, until you mess up real bad. And then you go, oh my God, and you start trying to come down back. So you get home, you work harder, you do more. You go, oh, I remember when I had peace. But you see, he is your peace. So this means that you leave the beginning and you're trying to produce things that only God can do. And that's why God placed you in Christ. And took it a step further, placed his son in you, which is what we want to get into in the very beginning.
What are you saying? Doesn't mean that you were there.
No, it's more like a father sitting down with his wife and kids, and a wife and saying, you know, one day we're going to have kids, and we're going to have this, we're going to provide this for them, and we're going to, we're going to work for the first 5 years of our marriage, and we're going to develop this and that so that they'll have something, you know, having a beginning before they began. And then you have them, and you go, oh, it's a boy, what are we, you know, that's, I think, the heart of the father, you are there. Now, we already discussed this a lot of the other day here, but we discussed the difference between that concept and the concept of foreknowledge. And God, in his foreknowledge, could look into the future, see you, see your rightful place, see your whole existence on the earth, grow up, and see how you live. You know, he can see everything about you and go, and then smile within himself and go, oh, they're going to be here one day. But I really believe that the references, many of these references, are not really on that basis, though God is capable of doing that because God has a foreknowledge. But I believe what we're talking about is not foreknowledge, but the heart of the Father. And the heart of the, and we got into all this on concrete and passion, a whole bunch of stuff. But it is, you have been delivered from the power of darkness and translated into the kingdom of his dear Son. Son of his love. That's over in Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. Jesus steps into the water and God speaks and he says, this is my beloved Son. Now, here's the guy that's going to keep the devil free. Or here's the guy that's finally doing right. But he's God, right? Now, you understand why he goes, this is my beloved Son. There is this relationship between the Father and the Son that you and I have entered into. And verse 14 really shows us, and the world was made pleasant over money, and we beheld his glory. What was his glory? The glory of the only begotten of the Father. We saw that. He didn't say we beheld his glory, how he can turn, you know, stones into bread. Wow. Or, you know, we always, these are the things we call glory. Writers, the ones God chose to write the Bible, didn't get off on all the temporal things that happened in Jesus' life. Put it down in that sense, it got off on Jesus. He said, man, we saw, you know, and I love 1 John, that which was from the beginning we have seen. Now, Jesus finally showed up and we got to be partaker of good stuff. He did. And that's what we would say. Because we're interested in Jesus, they can touch our temple. But they begin to see that they are in and of this one. And they have complete security in the Logos. Because the only way there can truly be a breakdown is for there to be a breakdown between the Father and the Word. I was going to say
that what you're speaking of is an intimate relationship, like you said, between the Father and the Son, which is a very intimate relationship, which supersedes any authority and power that God has given you. And the foreknowledge and all of that would attribute to the power, authority, and majesty of God that he's doing something, but you're speaking of something that even supersedes that intimate relationship between the two.
It's very good, because see, at this point, in this beginning, creation didn't come until later. In the beginning was the Word, was with God, the Word was God, the same as in the beginning with God. All things were created by him, by this beginning, this relationship. Okay. Down here, the devil shows up. Down here, sin shows up. Down here, sickness shows up. Down here. And now, all of a sudden, this one who is the Word has to be the Redeemer. When in this beginning, didn't need no Redeemer. He has to be a healer, and there was no sickness in this relationship. And when it's all over with, folks, there ain't going to be no sickness, there ain't going to be no... And what God are we going to know? Which one are we going to have related to all these years? The healer, the redeemer, and everything, and then we stand before him and go, I don't know if you anymore. Who are you? Since he's not going to be doing all that stuff for you. You know. And so, those are temporal things, and he does those, and those are the didn't need it to survive or to thrive. It was just, it was Lord's. And as Jerry pointed out, it wasn't a thing of power like down here where we see the glory of his power. It was a thing of endless. This, the Father says, my friends, in whom pleasure I am well pleased. See, in whom? Now the word is right and is perfect. In whom I am well pleased. And we try to copy Jesus instead of getting in the Logos. Or we don't even see him as the Logos. The complete thought and concept of God in whom you will be accepted. We see him as by whom I'm well pleased, and he's going to deal with this, and he's going to deal with that, and so we look to him for his intervention, we look to him for his power, we look to him to do for us in our short span, to improve our short span, when all the while, his whole thing is to take you to the cross, and then raise you up, and seat you together with him in heavenly places, in Christ Jesus, where you have been blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And there, you don't have near as much problem with the enemy because you've been raised up far above all principalities, powers, minds, and dominions, and every name that is named. I don't mean this world is an average to come. Okay, now that's already been done. That's not going to happen. By the way, if you're looking towards the rapture, this is not what the beast is referring to. This is what is settled. But the devil, his realm of territory, he is the god of this world. His realm, his territory in which he has the ability to operate, happens to be the sense realm. He can deal with your soul, he can deal with your body. But he cannot touch your spirit. And if you walk in the spirit, if you learn to plug into the Lord, you that wicked one toucheth you not. Somebody said, well, Randy, you're the one talking about the devil all the time. I have to. Because if you're going to stay in the sense realm, I've got to use power and God's authority and the name of Jesus and all this stuff. And you know, I get the devil done off your back temporarily unless you keep going. But Ralph, I can still, you know, it's kind of the maintenance job. It's what it is. Every time I 50,000 miles, we'll have to, you know, clean you up or whatever. But the truth is, that's not God's plan. That isn't. That's not what he did. See, he came down here, and that's what they thought. He came down here, and when he walked, he cast out demons, and everybody went, whoa, let's follow him. And he healed the sick, and they said, whoa, let's follow him. And he started feeding everybody, and they started going, whoa, let's follow him. This feels good. This is the guy we want to be king. And Jesus said, after they all started coming after him to make him king, based on that, Jesus went and started hiding himself and said, I've got to go away. I've got to leave. And they're going, what do you mean? You are exactly what we need. You are the promised Messiah. You are the fulfillment of all our hopes in the sense realm. You're exactly what we didn't want. And he went, I'm going to die and leave. I'm going to go to another place, and you're going to be with me there. Where are you going to go? Are you going to kill yourself? Anybody remember that was the conversation? Why are you going to kill yourself? What's going on? Don't leave us. He's going, if I don't leave, the Holy Spirit can't come and tell you the truth. Right now, you are so sense-minded, you need some spirit input. Spirit. You know. So what we do, we get the Holy Spirit. We go, okay, Holy Spirit, I want you to ride on the hood of my car and go on anybody close me to me, and I want you to make sure that I'm healed and healthy and happy, and you know, and I want Holy Ghost goosebumps every time I go to church. That is the epitome of spirituality for me, Holy Ghost goosebumps. Yeah. Up here at the Bible school and walk in the mall and get goosebumps. You know, God is trying to teach you, and you're just enjoying the experience, I guarantee, and I know what I'm talking about, you will lose the experience, or it will have little effect in your life. God is not wasting his time on temporal things, although I will say God is just glad to do it. So if that, you know, he will just, you know, I was talking to somebody the other day, and I said, you know, if somebody's just flat feeling bad and they're not looking to the Lord at all, God just come on and heal them. He's just flat good. He's done that to me so many times I can't even tell. But he would really rather me go, it's just stupid, I shouldn't go by my senses. I mean, okay, if I have, I mean, you know, that it's not a denial that I feel bad. But I can't expect God every time to pick me up. I would get up. You know, David encouraged himself in the Lord as God because the whole body was ready to stone. Now, you tell me what is more spiritual. God would come down on David, roll him around 3 or 4 times on the ground, pop him up like this and jump around, and then he would, oh, I'm ready to move with the Holy Ghost because I feel him all over me. Or for him to pick himself up and say, get up, you self-centered, sinful person. You need to follow God because God is worthy to be followed. Let's go. Let's see God get the most glory out of it. You know, sticking his hand in the bucket going, hey, hey, hey. Or us saying, I'm with the Lord. Come on. Good question. Which does the Lord get the most glory out of? And, you know, the problem that I face is that I'm called. That's the problem I face. I'm called. I know I'm called. I know I exist on this planet. Does this sound weird? I exist on this planet to preach things. God opened my eyes to see this. I must preach things. Is Kenneth Hagin called to preach the power that God is in here? I believe Kenneth Hagin, I'm sorry, I believe he's called God. Okay, what do you think, or how much you like or dislike Hagin or Copeland or whatever, I believe God has called them to do it. Now, if they take it off or they go to or whatever, that's why. If I take it off or go to point, anybody knows, that's their business. But I believe they're called for this thing. And I believe they were called for the time where we needed a power in the earth. I believe I'm called for the time where we need the Spirit movement, walking in the Spirit instead of having the Spirit walk in us, you know what I mean? Like a puppet. So, you know, a lot of people are waiting for God to move, and they don't ever do anything. And they're just sitting there like this, you know? Well, you know, when God does something in me, I'm ready to go, man. You know, and it's like, we want like a puppet. And God's going, I don't want you to be like a puppet. I want you to be my son. I want you to do this because you believe in me and my business, and you're with me, and you're going to get up and be about my business. You don't feel like whatever, you know. And that's a change because you see a child that carries out the garbage and stuff like that because they're supposed to, but then you see them as they begin to mature. What do? They start offering to do stuff, and you find them working around doing things and this and that, not even asking. You go, what is the difference? I'm going, well, you know, it's my house too. At first, it's wow. What a change. Oh, but it's good. Because then you feel like you're becoming workers together instead of just taking care of the little ones. The family's becoming tribute to the Spirit of the Lord.
I mean, I'm a full spirit, closer to God, and so it's not like I'm down.
let me say this, though. I mean, I believe it becomes a basis of maturity that you begin to accept the word of the cross above just the Spirit moving on you. Because I believe that new Christians have, for a period of time, you not only need, you have to have the Spirit of God moving on you. If it wasn't for the Spirit of God just moving on me and doing stuff, I wouldn't be here. That's the truth. I value revival because I wanted the power of God. I needed a touch from God. If it wasn't for that, I promise you, I wouldn't be here. God just, let me do that. I jumped and shouted and did all this stuff. It felt good. He kept me going. And I believe there are probably people here that, first of all, I don't believe you understand this until God starts opening your eyes. And in the meantime, God's going to be faithful to this stuff for you because God's faithful. Because this thing is greater than anything that I teach. This is really God. It really is God of the whole world. He really does watch out for his people. And that neither my words nor Kent Hagin's truly miss, like throw a wall in front of you and God or anybody else. Because God's going to be faithful. But it's easier for God to minister to somebody that needs a touch or needs him to touch them or call on them or a good word to them than it is to open their understanding that they don't need to walk by that anymore, they don't need to mature. It's easy. That's why you see that God can pour out his Spirit in different places. He will. Forever and ever will do that until the end. He'll always pour out his Spirit. I believe there has to be a coming together of all of this because Spirit power, love, all of it is one person. It's through Christ. And I think we need to accept that all is one. But I think when we're drawn away from his fullness by what he does, then something should be said. That's another thing you end up with that. I dream about you raising your hand.
I'm just going to say it because it's true. The Word,
Spirit in the beginning, before there was anything else, the Word manifested. And the truth, that which is real, will manifest. Meaning, you'll be able to see it, feel it, taste it, touch it. Manifesting means it comes, it'll happen, you'll be able to see it shown down here with your eyes on this. Again, that was just from the beginning where you're seeing the hand of touch. But they knew from where it was and they saw it and handled it, touched it. I see absolutely no good of having a God or having a Lord or having a Savior that sits up in heaven and never, you know, there's no contact, there's no reality, there's no, it's just kind of a woo, you know, spooky kind of deal. I believe fully that a true relationship with the Father through the love of through His Son is very practical on a daily basis. And I believe it is a living relationship that you are, I mean, it's a spiritual thing, but it has practical implications constantly. It's not just something you go to church on Sunday and think about. It is how you operate and in what spirit you operate, by what principles do you operate. And so the Word was made flesh. The truth is there in the Spirit, it will eventually manifest in the flesh. And we need the Word to be made flesh around here. You know? I mean, it's wonderful. We can all talk about these truths. We can open our Bible and share. That's wonderful, but it's very sad if brother or sister is in need and the spirit of that is not there. In Mexico, during the conference, I thought a contrast between the word of the cross and the way of the cross. The word of the cross being receiving the message of the cross. And the way of the cross being taking up the cross daily. Find yourself, you know what I mean? That's kind of two different things. One's getting down a message and being able to preach it real well, impressing. The other one is, there's a need over there, gee, I need to go get the Word. You know what I'm saying? There's a need over there, and I need Jesus. Okay? No?
Reservoir, and as it empties out, we must go back and fill up.
would be panicked. I don't know if anybody's going to be able to identify. My reservoir, in other words, I read the Bible and see something, and then read somebody's book and get some nugget, somebody share something and have, you know, so I have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 good nuggets in there. You know what I mean? When I got them good nuggets in there, I feel good about myself. This is called being spiritual. Okay? So what I would do is that I would share those things. You know, people come up and I would share one of those nuggets, you know, and then stand up in chapel and share one of those nuggets, you know, and maybe the same one I shared with that other person, and then my family share one on the pill. Can't share that nugget anymore, I'm sharing with everybody. You know, and you do that enough times with those 7 that you got, you're down to 3. And your schedule is pretty rough, and you're going like, God, I'm getting low on nuggets, and, you know, I don't want to look like I'm not spiritual, so I need to, okay, and the Lord reigns to, in my case, over and over and over again. And that would happen. Sure enough, I'm going, oh, man, you know, and I'm just, you know, maybe I'll be at work or doing something and waiting to get back, you know, so I get, you know, get it, and I'm itching, and I'm ready. Get home, get pops, get to church, whatever. You're going, oh, okay. Sure enough, the need pops up. You know what I mean? And it's like, the Lord, you know the Lord wants you to go over there and do that. You're going, you know, and they haven't seen you yet. So maybe you can slip out or whatever. Because inside of me, what I would do is I would go, oh, man, I just want the Lord. I just want the Lord. I just want the Lord. I need the Lord. I got to have the Lord, you know? And really, a lot of that really, 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 truly wasn't I need the Lord. It was I need more nuggets. Some of you might know what I mean. It's like, I need more nuggets. But I don't function well on 3 nuggets. Because when they're gone, I'm going to look like an idiot, and I don't want to look like it. So I go, oh, okay, and I go through this struggle. You know, and the Spirit of God would let me know, hey, go over there and help. And there were many a time, this is the truth, many a time that I didn't do that. I went to God's Word, and, you know, most of the time, I can honestly say, from my experience may not be your experience, or yours doesn't match or anything close to go by mine, but I'm just giving this as an example. But most of the time, when I go spend the hour that they're doing whatever they're doing in the Word, then I wouldn't get anything. It would be so dry and so, and I would sit there under guilt thinking, that was kind of what it was. Then the Holy Spirit began to teach me. There's a scripture in Proverbs, and there's scriptures all over that say the same thing. There's one of them that says, he that watereth shall be watered himself. Anybody ever read that scripture? He that watereth shall be watered also himself. Well, if you got enough water to water, why do you need water? Well, maybe you don't have enough water to water. Remember the woman who gave the widow, who gave the widow's mite? Jesus said, I love this. Jesus, on this earth, really suffered for the water. Really was. I mean, it's so different even than that. But what scripture says this, it says, and Jesus sat watching them put into the offering, you know, whatever, I don't remember what it was like, but like all the people there. He sat and watched them. You know, it's funny, I was thinking, what are you doing while I'm watching them? I mean, can you imagine that? And then Jesus says this, you know, the widow puts in hers. He says to the disciples, because he's ever teaching principle. Right? He's always talking the principle of the kingdom of God. And always, that's what he's all about. He knows that's going to make them true disciples if they start getting it. So he says, you know, most of these people have given because of their abundance. But this woman has given more than all. And she gave a little bit, you know, I don't even know. Anybody remember what a mite is? How much?
10.
What is it?
10.
10th of a penny, that's right. 10th of a penny. And Jesus said, she gave more than you all. Okay, that right there takes it out of the worldly principle realm. You can tell, right? I mean, immediately, that's not the principle of this earth. But it is the principle. principle of the kingdom of God, the way he the way he is, the way he thinks, his economy. He says she's given more than all because she has given out her lack, not out of her lack. Because that's when, you know what I mean? You know what? Anybody ever had an offering plate go around and go, anybody got change for a 10? You know what I mean? Or worse, anybody got change for a 5? Or whatever. When the scripture says, he that watereth shall be watered also himself, it's not based on some sort of principle that if you've got plenty of water, you can water, you'll be watered yourself. I believe it's based on the principle of, man, I got a choice here. I really need to get the word, and I'm freaking out. And part of that is, that's when you need to learn to lay all your motives out and find out what's really going on. Because we smother over with this motive. It's only God at work here. Learn to dissect our motives and find out that there may be several, but okay, and then go, okay, I don't have it right now. But I do have the life of Christ. And there's a need, and I believe, now sometimes you're not supposed to. Sometimes it costs you not to. And I'm talking about in this case, you go lay down your life, and I promise you I'll have this happen, may not end up in your experience, but I've had it happen to you. Gave myself away. Somebody may walk by and just quote a scripture to me. Spirit of God, don't lift it up like that. It's like I spent 2 hours in the Word. I've had that happen anytime. You just go, or you just look down and you just get 2 minutes, you know, while you're driving somewhere and you look down, and the Lord just comes, you go, I'm being watered. Because why should you get to a selfish person in an effort to make them more selfish? Kind of not into that. You know. But if you go, man, there's a need right here, I'm going to give myself. And the other part of this is the Word is being made flesh. It is, you know, what is the point of just having to look around someone right there? He wants to be made flesh and dwell among us. This is how he tabernacles. He dwells among us. I mean, this is, Jesus is not here in a body running around. In his body. And really, we're all, Jesus is here in the midst of us, you know what I mean? You know, I think I sense him right over the corner there. You know, I mean, we are the body of Christ. We are his hands, and we are his feet, and we are his eyes, and we are his ears. And if Jesus is going to touch the world over there, he's going to do it right over there. You know what I mean? The other night, before you come, this is going to be the other night. Well, that Sunday night, me and Don Anderson, we were out late, we bought and everything, we shared and everything. So he was going to drop me back off the church. And just as I pulled up out, I pulled up this big thing with all the stuff to get to the end of it, I honestly can say, I'm like, praise God, it's a good thing that I showed up just at this right time. And always say everything's always perfect at that time. Like nobody was around. I'm going to the kitchen. I'm going to be, but I'm ready to fit in there. That, now we all start pulling off. And so, I kind of hit that out. We'll check it out with the guys over there in the mission. And they come walking over. Steve looked really, half asleep, everything. Steve says, I figured you'd be coming. I just figured it was going to be late. And his spirit was such that it's almost like I really figured it'd be 3 in the morning. I was prepared to get up at 3 and come help you. You know, and it was just a blessing coming out of it. He's going, it's not easy to be woke up, so come help us unload this thing, whatever. Well, let me tell you something. That's Christ, and that doesn't live Steve though, because that ain't Steve. I know Steve. No, it's not. He knows that. He knows I know that about him, and that's not Steve. But that is Christ. And what does that say? We need the
identity in terms of like, yeah, well, that'd be good, you know, that's, so then you adopt this identity as you know, this one who shared nuggets, and therefore when you start to run out of brick, your identity, so you had to run, you know, until you got over that a little bit, and then you find that's what sort of considered it, though.
Yeah, I think so. I think that some of it, though, is, because really a lot of the people that I respected were people who really would get into the but I think that I think it developed me more than wrong people or something. I respected that part of them particularly that they could share. They didn't seem to be able to share good stuff all the time. And I thought, man, you know, I mean, I like that. There's nothing wrong with that. I don't think my original motives were bad. But I think that pretty soon I put a premium on that rather than anything else. And some of those very people that I respect ended up being some of the tools that helped me realize because I could see it in their life. That's it. But yeah, I think that's right. I mean, what identity we want. You know, it's so funny, Josh. There's some people that they're just flat workers. They'd rather work than get to work. And they're the ones that need to get to work and quit working sometimes. Because it's their idea.
Sure.
But Christ is the Word, and He manifests. And I believe that if we desire to know Him and have a relationship with the Father through Him, that as we do, we will know Him, we will be like Him, and in so doing, we will find ourselves more in our life now because it's just like that. It takes a little bit of time, and maybe everybody doesn't have to go through the front of the road that I was afraid of.
Yeah, I was going to say, the Holy Spirit showed me how I get in the Word, and how, you know, I'm where I get in the Word, but really it was to be in motion that would occur when the Holy Spirit came. But it was not because the revelation came to me. Of course, I love the Word. So when my emotions were down, I felt dry emotionally. So I need the Lord. So it wasn't necessarily me. It was like I identified what was comfortable with my circumstances. Really, spiritualized right into the Word of God and the emotion.
You know, and it's interesting, too, that the Holy Spirit become a Word. And instead of the principle being the primary thing, it is the fact that God touches you, ministers you, and feeds your flesh. And you may never have really gotten the truth. You may need to be shown that over and over and over. But you're not really looking for the truth. You're looking for the
okay. Yeah, see, the temptation that I have, or that I can relate to God in this whole thing, is, you know, everybody likes to get up and say, you know, whatever, blah, 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 and everybody go, whoa. And that's self-gratification, and you want that to be out of your identity, and then somehow you place a premium on it. You know, you can dig a ditch if people can't relate to the work based on, oh, yeah, that's cool. But, you know, you sure, they want to take out the lunch, and I say, you know, hey, you know, how'd that go? And, you know, that's just like,
you're sitting there in the lunch room.
Yeah,
this is so hard.
And I find that the worst thing, not only not letting the real Christ manifest and being at work, is there's an overwhelming temptation when you don't have any nuggets to make something up.
Yeah.
To keep that thing going.
I wasn't real good at making it up, but I tell you what, there is with me.
You know what, I don't mean like totally maliciously,
no.
But I mean to spiritualize and try to make a nugget out of something that's no more than some neat little piece of information that you dug out.
I think with each person we've got here, the emotional, their this side, their, you know, my side, I think with each person you're going to find a different angle on this truth. But I'm a good man.
Well, it's just that when the Lord had called you to be a man of the Word, or a man of the Word, you're committed to the Word. So this is like the lowest level here, okay, of that ministry that He called you to.
Right.
It's the getting of nothing. So then He caused you to grow, so that the Word has to be manifested. But that could also be that bottom
living, you know what I'm saying? However, it's real hard to discern sometimes, but sometimes it would be quote ministry to go over there and minister while I need to go over there and minister the word. I mean, you've got to, that's why you've got, everybody here needs to realize that you have layers of motives. You have different motives. We always think we have one motive, and if the devil tells you it's the flesh, then you break out of it. And if you want to center on what you know is of God, then that will justify other motives. I mean, there's so many ways of doing this thing, you know. But we need to all, because nobody else is going to do this for us. We need to all, I keep saying this, it's like the table of our heart, lay everything out there and go, really and truly, this is one of the reasons I'm not happy to say it is, but this is one of the reasons why I need, and you haven't made any decisions yet, you're just examining what's going on in you. Okay, now this is the Lord right here. This is my flesh. This is definitely the devil. This is, you know, and as much as you can, and the more you do this, the more the Holy Spirit will give you discernment. And pretty soon, you'll be able to just very simply, when it comes to decision time, you'll be able to go, boom, 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 and you'll go, okay, this is the Lord. My flesh wants it. The very same thing that God wants, but it wants it for its reason. So we're going to do this because it's the Lord, but we ain't going to do it for my flesh for its reason. And I ain't going to feed my soul in the process for doing it. In fact, I turn to my soul and I go, you ain't getting nothing out of this. We're doing this for God. And then you begin to make decisions. So you know, if that other thing's still a motive, do you even know what temptation is? You know, temptation is a desire or a feeling or a want to. Temptation is not sin. It's only sin when you let it govern you and you act on it because it has governed your decision. You know. We all go, oh no, Calvin, I was thinking about, you know, did you act on it? Did you do it for that reason? No, I did it for God that I was thinking about. Oh wow, you did tempt me, weren't you? But you didn't go with the temptation. No, I didn't, but I was thinking about it. You know? And that's like Jesus in the garden, you know? I mean, can you see him sitting there going, oh, I swear, praise God, the blood, man, my soul's in the light.
With the Lord, and if someone else comes in or a circumstance or something,
like, you know, the scripture says, if a man looks on a woman with lust after, he's already committed adultery in his heart. If not a man in this world, he has struggled with that scripture at one point or another. And I've had people shove that at me when I talk about this and say, well, what about that? I mean, if it's in there, you've already committed adultery in your
heart. I heard something really encouraging about that.
To deliver him, he went outside and smoked a cigarette. don't know what you're talking about either.